Hey, this is Tom, Junkie XL, and welcome to Studio Time with Junkie XL. Who else? So, these are a couple of special episodes coming up, and we're going to feature completely on Tomb Raider that is hitting the theaters this weekend. And I want to do 4 unique tutorials about certain scenes and explain a little bit how I work. So in this tutorial, we're going to focus on the queue 2M11. That means it's queue number 11 in real 2, and it's called the Crypt. Now, I'm not going to tell you too much about what this movie is all about, because that would be spoiler alerts, and I would not want to ruin your movie experience, so I'm not going to do that. But I want to talk to you in this particular episode how I start from scratch and how I build up the track and everything else that's there. It's a fairly long queue. It's 8.5 minutes, roughly. But you have a really good overview on what I do for this particular scene. Now, this scene is very electronic in nature. So some of the other queues that we've done last year were very orchestral in nature. This is a very electronic queue in nature. But before I get really into it, I wanted to play you the 2 themes that are represented here. One is Lara's theme, which is a very simple melody. I'll play it a melody. So that's the opening statement of her theme. Let me play the harmony that goes with it. Bear with me, I'm not a great piano player. So very simple in nature, and it lends itself really well to do arpeggios, to do action versions of it, or a very emotional version. Now let me go to the second theme, which is Lara's dad, and that theme is... So very simple line as well. They share the same rhythmic structure, and they're also both in the same key. So it's very easy to mix and match them up between the two if needed, which actually happens quite a lot. So let's go to the queue here, and let's just see what we all see here. We see obviously the MIDI parts. At this point, I only have the MIDI parts selected that actually are playing in this queue. And I would like to point out that the way that we play the queue right now is with all the MIDI strings, with all the MIDI brass, and all the programming. So this was the last stage of this queue before we actually went in and recorded it in London. But we'll get to that later. So I want to hide at this point all my MIDI tracks and just focus a bit on what we see up here. And what we see up here is the marker list up top, then we see the time-based marker list second, then we see the signature track here, and here we see the tempo track. So before I do really any writing at all, I'm just basically playing back the scene a couple of times, and I'm trying to figure out in my head what the tempo of this scene is going to be. So I'm just like snapping along, I'm watching it, I was like, oh, maybe slower, maybe faster. And then at a certain point when I feel I have a general tempo that could really work, I start with the tempo map. At this point, I felt like a tempo, let's bring up my thing here, around 80 was working pretty well throughout the whole queue. But you see there are some tempo changes here and there. And the reason why that is there is because you want to sometimes hit a certain shot. And in order to do that, you have to, you know, play around with the tempo a little bit. You have to play around with your meter track a little bit to make sure that you get there every time when you need to be on a certain shot. So let's now just play this thing with just a click. And this is how I would do it. I would just like play the scene with the click, and I would determine whether the click feels good, whether the rhythm feels good. And once I'm happy with what that tempo and what the click is doing, then I'm going to look at my meter changes and at my markers. So let me explain a little bit how that works. So I'm playing the scene. And I would like to say, I really wish I could play the scene, but none of these movie companies will ever allow me to actually feature the raw footage that I work with into my studio times, unfortunately. Because it would be so great to show you the actual scene and that we could talk about what's happening in the picture and why I make certain decisions. But unfortunately, I never get permission to do that. Let's just play this thing right here. And then I made a marker here at bar 43, like something should start with the piano. And then I move on, and then I would say something needs to get more serious here. Constantly looking at the picture and the dialogue and, you know, depending on what's being discussed. So the cool thing is, I start doing all these markers, and as you can see, this is an 8.5 minute cue, and it goes, you know, all the way up there until the end of the cue. And you see all these little markers saying, like, you need to go bigger, you need to fade out here, more strings here, the theme starts playing here, we need to go bigger there. And what's really interesting when you do this on four hands with just a click, is you kind of start scoring the scene already in your head. And by the time you're done with the markers, you just need to put all the music bits in. So it's a way of working that I really like, and it also keeps it very organized for myself. Now, so that's the marker track. We talked a little bit about the tempo track, and now let's discuss the meter track. So let's go to a certain bit in the track. So I see the meter changes here. So here we see, for instance, a 3-4 and a 5-8, and I'm back to a 4-4. So normally when you write a piece of music, you would never have meter changes like that, because you write in 4-4 or in 3-4 or in 6-8, whatever. But since we're talking film scoring and you're looking at a scene, but the scene might be over earlier and the music is still playing. So therefore, in this case, I went from a 3-4 to 3-1-2-3-4-5-1-2-3-4. And most likely at bar 100 where that happened, it's an important shot that we see on screen and the music needs to start all over. And that's why I have these meter changes in there. And in combination with tempo changes, I'm able to then hit a shot like pretty dead on. Now let's look at the other marker track, which is the time-based marker track. The time-based marker track is a marker track where the markers are locked to a time code. So whatever edits you make in the tempo track, in the signature track, or global cuts or global inserts, those markers will always stay on the same SMPTE time. And now, why would that be interesting, you might ask? If you do conforms, and a conform is that you have to rework a piece of music because you scored the piece of music to an original version of the film, let's say version number 8. And now we're at version number 14, we get the picture back and we play the same scene. And what has happened is that the scene is now 30 seconds shorter over that whole 8.5 minute time period, which means that you need to conform the original cue that you wrote to the new picture version. And you need a couple of tools to do that effectively. And one of them is how I work, is that I have my markers that are beat-based, and so they're basically glued to whatever bar you're working on. So if you have a marker at bar 99, even if you change the tempo or you make global cuts and conforms, like, that marker will always stay on 99. So if the tempo is slower, which means the music is longer, but that marker will still be at bar 99. Whereas the time codes marker will always stay to time code. So the time code markers will tell me where the original changes in the music were, and the beat marker will tell me where they are now. And so it's a good way to keep track of certain things that always need to, that always happened at a certain spot, and then when you edit them to a new spot. So it's just a way to make things a little easier on that end. And conforms can get really, really tricky. Very complicated. So now that we're done with the tempo and the markers and the meter changes, now let's open up the instruments. So I'm just unmuting these two big group folders. One is called scoring. So that folder basically has everything in there, from strings to brass to woodwinds and everything that has anything to do with the orchestra. And the top folder is JXL instruments, and everything in here is sound design, drums, bass guitars, synthesizers, you name it. Okay, so let's now play this 8.5 minute cue, and then we're gonna go really into it, what is there. And again, I'd like to point out, this is the latest version demo of this cue that was approved by the director and the studio. And after that, we went into the recording of it. So let's just play this cue. Thank you. Okay, that's it. The full 8.5 minutes. And in this episode, I primarily want to focus on the electronic sounds that have been used in this cue. As you can tell, the orchestra is pretty simple. I showed you a couple of the MIDI parts. So therefore, I want to focus more on the electronic side of things. So let's just start at the top. And here we have a bunch of different sounds coming from a bunch of different synthesizers. I've used the Omnisphere here with a couple of patches that I did. The Diva is being used by Yuhi. Let's see what else. The Zebra is in here a couple of times. So the Contact a lot with custom made instruments. So let's just go through them and see what all these sounds are doing. So let's just select these three here. And I actually want to put on a function. Let's see, and that is, I'm just scanning my touch panel because I barely use it, so I have to, let's see, track selection follows event selection, which means, yes, if I select the parts, the tracks are going to get selected too. So I found it, it's right here. So, okay, let's go to these bass lines here, which are very soft in nature. Let's turn my volume up a little bit. Okay, so let's just check what's going on with these ones. What plugins are on this. So on the first one, I used the FabFilter filter, which is automated. So it basically takes the high end off and back on. And the effects that I'm using here is a delay that goes to the front and a delay that goes to the back. So let's look at that second sound, which has the, okay, let's go back. I'm doing this on one screen right now. I'm totally not used to this, so bear with me for a second. Usually I have two screens, but for the tutorial purposes, it's easier to have one screen so you guys can see everything better. So those sounds right there, again, very soft in nature. And here I'm using the dub station and also the filter and the autopan. The autopan is a really nice tool made by Steinberg, and you can basically set the if you want to have it a quarter note, an eighth note, or a 16th note, or any other division. You can play around with the face so it gets really wide, and you can just determine like how you want this thing to move. You can edit everything yourself. It's pretty great to use it for LFO purposes. The dub station is one of my analog delays of choice. It's made by Audio Damage, and it's a fantastic tape delay. Again, you can play around here with the sync on and off. You can determine whatever time you want there. I think it's set to a quarter note at this point. And then the third bass doesn't have a plugin on it, but it has a huge amount of auxiliary sense. So it goes to the Valhalla Dark Front, which is a really long reverb. The Valhalla is a fantastic reverb, and it goes to the front, and a version of it goes to the back for surround purposes. And then we have another delay going to the front and a delay going to the back. We could quickly look at these effects. So here is the Valhalla Dark. So this is one of the reverbs that I'm using going to the front, and there's a second one going to the back. Great sounding plugin. And here we have the delays that are being used, which are two FabFilter delays, the Timeless. And one of them is going to the front, one of them is going to the back with different delay times. So you really get a nice wide sound. Okay, let's go back to our VST tracks, and let's go back to our main window, arrangement window. So now we have a bunch of basses here. Let's just play those. So also darker in nature, even though a little bit more aggressive than the first ones. Let's see what's going on here with plugins, inserts. Also here we see the autopan. that we just discussed, but I'm using this thing too, which is really awesome. This is a Waves plugin, and it allows you to put the left or the right side out of phase, and you can play with the delay time of it. So if we just were to, let's say I'm just gonna use this thing here, and then we could play with or without, and so you could hear the difference. So you hear that the bass is getting really, really wide. If I bypass it, it's almost mono. So with this thing, you could delay the right side or the left side in milliseconds, whatever you want, and you could really create that feeling that the music is taking place out of the speaker. So it's a really powerful plugin, especially if you use it in conjunction with the Autopan. Also here, a few auxiliary synths. Also the Valhalla is being used, but now we're using the Valhalla Bright to the front and to the back, so we can check that out. It's the same plugin basically, but it has settings that make it a brighter reverb. So there's more high end, and it has a lot of chorusing going on. But you see here the high cut is pretty high, whereas we go to the dark, it's set to lower there. So you could see that the reverb is not as bright, and it's longer on the lower frequencies. Works quite effective to have different reverbs in your setup to create a sound that is fuller. Okay, back to the VST mixer channel. Again, if you guys want to know how my template works and the way that I set up my mixer and my effect settings, I would highly advise you to go to Studio Time Season 1, where there's an episode just focusing on this, the routing and how it's all being set up. So if you want to know more about that, just please watch that. So the next track is a resample of a bass pulse. Let's just play that thing. So it's basically the combination of the two basses that you just heard before. I recorded it in as audio, and I stuck a bunch of plugins on it to make something else. So I'm just going to my inserts, and we see there's quite a lot of inserts here. So let's open them all up. So the first one is the 914 by Audio Damage, and it's actually, I've showed this plugin to you guys before. It's a copy of that famous Moog filter of the Modulus series, and this one sounds really, really awesome. So five plugins in a row. Let's explain what they do. So if I play this sound and then switch this thing on off, you'll hear it. So it adds like almost like that bell type of quality to it, which is really nice, I think. The second plugin over is again the Fab Filter Timeless set to certain settings, so it bounces back and forth. Then after that, we see the Fab Filter, the Simplon filter on read. So you could see here that it does all these moves, and you could bring out the resonance and then a little open and then a little close. Really nice filter for that. Then it goes to the Decapitator made by Soundtoys, another fantastic plugin by these guys. And this is like a distortion plugin, but you can use it very mild, and you can use it also extremely aggressive. So it has everything from just a little bit to like completely over the top. Beautiful plugin. After that, we have the Waves API 2500, another fantastic plugin by Waves. Very good sounding compressor. It's all, most of the time the go-to compressor for me, because it's also low on DSP, so you could have hundreds of them open in your Cubase session without even a dent into the processing. So these five plugins together are making this particular bass sound. So let's now go out of here. And let's go to the next group of tracks. So I did something similar here with the two pans. So two pans is a percussion instrument, which is loaded in my template. But also here you hear that there's quite some processing going on here to give it like a certain quality. So here we have three plugins. Two are already familiar, which is the Simplon by Fab Filter, again to do these type of moves on the audio, a compressor to hold everything together, the 2500 by Waves. And here we have the Volcano, which is a fantastic filter plugin, also made by FabFilter. And the great thing is it's Dutch, so it doesn't get better than that. And there's all these incredible things you can do with this filter. It's kind of, you can move stuff around like a wah-wah. It has multi-bands. It's really fantastic. I would definitely check it out. It's a very unique plugin. So these plugins make that sound. Let's just move on because we have so many tracks to go through. Here we have a track that is called Deep Water, and that looks like an Omnisphere sound. Let's just see. And that's what that does. No plugins here, but a huge amount of auxiliary synths, as we see here. So one is going to the general doubler back, which is some sort of short delay with a chorus kind of effect that just goes to the surround speaker, so I can make a stereo track more happening in the back too. And we see a bunch of delays here. So this one goes to the general delay long, which is another timeless to the front, and another timeless going to the back, FabFilter. And also here we see the Valhalla dark front and the Valhalla dark to the back. So with these double auxiliary synths and effects channels, and again, look at my tutorial in season one, you can see how you can make stuff more interesting in the surround world if it's just a stereo track or a mono track to begin with. Let's look at some other sounds. Here we have one of my favorite sounds. It's the Zebra Stomper. It's basically just a really nice bass loop. Light and color has all these great opportunities to edit the sounds however you want it, and then just like automate it in. So this is the Zebra that was released, the Dark Zebra by Yuhi. I actually used the normal Zebra and this one just like through one another. It's like it reads all the sounds in both of the plugins. It has a few more options on this one that the other one doesn't have, but other than that, they're fairly similar. But it's a great sounding sound. You could very easy, with right click, you can assign it to either one of the XYZ controllers, and then in the performance page, you can just like automate that in. You can assign them to a mod wheel, aftertouch, or pitch blender, whatever you want. And you could just like automate the sounds and record it in as MIDI. So that's the Zebra. Then we have another Zebra, the Noise Loop, which is another one of my favorites. We can barely hear it here, but something is not correct. Oh, because the filter is all the way down. Here we go. Again, a sound that you can mangle and edit really nicely in the Zebra with attack and filters and whatever you might want. Then there's a bunch of resamples here. I'm just going to skip a few tracks here and there because otherwise it's going to be too much. So a very light percussive audio track with a little bit of auto pan on it. We just discussed that with the auto track. But also here you see the auxiliary synth. So there's a delay going to the front and a delay going to the back, which were the two timeless plugins by FabFilter that we just discussed. Here we have an Aturia arpeggio, and this is the Jupiter 8 synth. A beautiful synth. We've discussed this in Studio Time Season 2, where I actually compared the software synths with the real Jupiter 8, which I also have here. But it's a wonderful sounding plugin and really easy just to quickly get something down. So that's that sound. Here we have a contact instrument that I made myself. It's almost like a Mongolian sound. It's actually a mouth harp that I time stretched like 400% and then play it really low on the lower octaves. That's actually what that sound is. What do we have here? This is another contact instrument that I made. Let's see what that is. So I'm just opening up a contact right here, and you see all these guitar pedals here. And this, so this is a guitar sound that I made with all these pedals. There's an episode in season two where you actually see me use all these pedals to create these sounds, and then I resample it. So this is. So that's what that instrument does. It's really nice to make sounds with your own guitars and then turn them into instruments. So, but there's a Studio Time episode that deals with that of season two. So there's a bunch of guitar instruments in a row that do that. Then we get to some audio here, which is the dad's theme, Lara's dad's theme, with reversed pianos. So this is a normal piano that I recorded in. I'm sure I put like a bunch of plugins on it. Let's just see. Yeah. So there's that plugin again that we saw from Waves, where you can make things like super wide. Then I'm using this plugin, the Wobbler, which is really great to give it like some weird vibes. This is Melda. The brand is called Melda, and they have all these fantastic plugins, like so many of them. You should really look into their plugin stuff. It's unbelievable what they have. And this is the Autopan again by Steinberg that comes with Cubase. So that's that track. Let's move on a little lower. And then here we see a sound design instrument. And let's just play this thing. So, this is an instrument that was made with Make Noise, the Euro modular brand, fantastic brand. I think they're from New York. So it has the skin of the Make Noise modular stuff. And I built a lot of instruments with Make Noise by just like. So this was all done made on a Euro modular, and then, you know, turned it into a contact instrument. It's very handy to have really cool sounds like they're ready to go, like really quick. So that's another thing that I do a lot. Let's see, there's no inserts here, but you see a lot of auxiliary synths, pretty similar to what we have discussed before. There's a general stereo doubler to the back, and then we see two more Valhallas, one to the front, one to the back. And then we see a short delay going to the front and a short delay going to the back. Again, to make the sound a little wider and interesting. This thing is an Omnisphere. And it has this really nice icy patch. So that's what that is doing. Another important part of this cue is this minimal music piano type of riff. And there's a couple of riffs playing at the same time. So let's put them together. Let's play that. So there's a lot of processing going on here too. So, let's just open the mixer and find these two tracks. And there they are, right here on your right of the screen. So as you can see, a lot of auxiliary synths here, very familiar to what we've discussed before. And there's a plug, they both have the same plugin, which is again, that Waves plugin to make things wider and more stereo. So there's not too much going on actually here. I think I did the processing already somewhere else and then turn it into audio and put some extra effects on it. So that's that piano riff. Let's see, what do we have here? So we have, I think, another riff, piano riff recorded in. And this audio has already been treated with a sound design program because I don't see any plugins on top, but it's clearly being treated. And then I just use it as audio. Let's see, here we have a Omnisphere doing this. Some of the pads in Omnisphere are really fantastic, and I do change them always around just to make sure that it's not exactly the same as it comes as a preset, just to make sure that the, you know, the sound is as original as it can be. This is one of my favorite synths, and not many of you out there might actually know this synth really well, but this is Native Instruments App Synth, and it was a super big deal when this thing came out, like in 2001, 2002. And it wasn't Native Instruments back then, but then Native Instruments bought it, I think, something like that. But it's a very unique synthesizer that primarily deals with comp filtering, and that's how it creates this really, really unique sound. It has a huge amount of opportunities to route controllers to any parameter in the synthesizer. And it's actually quite complicated box to program, but the sounds are just like so incredibly amazing. So this one is a very like sitar-y kind of sound, I would almost say. So what do we have here? Here we have an interesting one, which is choir recordings that I did. So this is a live choir singing, and then with audio edits, I make it work like what bit I want to use. So it really has that quality of Ligeti, Arvo Pärt. So basically I just threw 30 ladies in one room, and we recorded this really atonal, shifty kind of choir, which was very nice to use for Tomb Raider, especially in the scenes later on. So we'll hear this sound again. Let's see what this is. This is. So this used to be, this is confusing because the audio part says brass, but it's actually a cluster of strings that are processed with plugins and such. Let's move on here. Oh, here we have something interesting. This is a cello resample. So, let's just see what does that. Oh, so this is already processed in a different program because I don't see any inserts here. So this was a recorded cello riff, and then treated with guitar amps and with guitar pedals to get that really MIDI type of sound that I really liked. Oh man, there's so many tracks to choose from. So these tracks that you see on top are the unique tracks that I did especially for this scene, and it's like roughly 100 or so that are unique, and then all the tracks below that are actually standard part of my template. So let's just view a few of these sounds more, and then we'll leave it at that. So this is some sound design-y pad. This is coming out of contact, so it's one of those sound experiments that I did. Let's see, what is this? Okay, so this is a low drone. Something more coming on here. Another low drone. What is this? Here you can hear the time stretch really well, so it's one of those. And also here, I'm just looking at the effect sense. There's quite some effect sense going on this track. Nothing that you haven't seen before. It's the same group of tracks that I usually use for these ambient sounds. So So this is actually made of a bowl, like a Tibetan bowl almost, and I time stretched it and pitched it up quite a lot, and you get this really typical granularized sound. So these are the unique tracks that were added to the template, and it's also in a folder called Special Projects Instruments. So if I close that, they're now all sitting in this purple folder. Those are all the tracks that we just discussed. Now, underneath, we find the tracks that are almost in every template. So it's like low hits, low whooshes, stuff like that, or a really low drum. Here we have our two pans. So that's the drum department. So I only have the track selected that I'm actually using in this cue, because otherwise it would be just too much. And then you see here some very simple orchestration stuff, some smaller string stuff, and a few horns and trombones, but nothing too major. So the most interesting part is actually happening in the special project instruments, and those were the instruments that we roughly just went through. To give you an idea of what kind of sound design I use in the cue like this. Okay, I really hope you liked this episode, and I'll see you soon with another Tomb Raider special. Thanks.